You know, the Bible says that men and women ought always to pray and not faint. Faint is a metaphor for giving up. Have you ever wanted to give up in this life? Sometimes we want to follow the lyrics of that country song, "Stop the World and Let Me Off." But it's always too soon to quit in service to our Lord. We'll talk about that today. Pastor Mark Hensley here from the Pikes Peak Park Baptist Church in Colorado Springs. We're so glad you're watching today. Let me know how I can specifically pray for you, and just know how honored we are that you're watching. Let's pray. Father, when we become weary of well-doing, remind us that we will reap a harvest if we don't faint. That is, give up. Help us to stay with our shoulder to the plow, moving forward, looking to you for every direction and guidance, and believing you for greater days. Lord, we pray for this country. We pray for an end to the war in the Ukraine, and we pray that people by the millions would come to know you in a personal way through their repentance of sin and trusting in the finished work of Christ on the cross. Thank you for him, and Holy Spirit, anoint the preaching of your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. Oftentimes, when I think of people wanting to quit, I'm reminded of a world-class endurance swimmer by the name of Florence Chadwick, who back in 1952 stepped into the icy waters off of the Pacific Ocean near Catalina Island, determined to swim to the shore of California, which was about 26 miles away. She had already been the first woman to swim the English Channel both ways. As she got into the water that day, the weather was, as it often is off the coast of California, it was foggy and chilly. She could hardly see much in front of her, the boat that was accompanying her, but she swam as she knew how for 15 hours, and then she begged to be taken out of the water. And her mom, who happened to be in a boat alongside her, said, "Florence, you're really close to the shore. Keep on going, keep on going." But she was physically and emotionally exhausted, and she stopped swimming and demanded that they pull her out. It wasn't until Florence was on the boat that they discovered that the shore was less than half a mile away. At a news conference, this is what she said: "All I could see was the fog. I think if I could have seen the shore, I would have made it." Can you relate to those words? We live our lives in the fog of trouble and worry, doubt, depression, various sundry problems, health problems, unemployment, financial uncertainty, strained relationships, the loss of loved ones. And sometimes we just want to quit. By the way, you may wonder what happened to Florence. Well, months later, she tried again. That same thick fog set in, but she succeeded in reaching California. She said that what helped her was she had a mental image of the shoreline as she swam. She later swam the Catalina Channel on two additional occasions. Consider Florence Chadwick's words: "I think if I'd have seen the shore, I would have made it." For Christians, I liked what Randy Alcorn once said. He said, "The shore is a person. It's Jesus. And the place is called heaven. We are made for a person and a place. Jesus is the person, and heaven is the place." Paul, the apostle, had the larger life in mind as he wrote to a young man named Timothy from the Mamertine prison in Rome. Today's message is entitled "Fulfill Your Ministry." And we're in the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 4. 1 through 5, "I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is the judge, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth, and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Well, how do you fulfill your ministry? Well, by preaching the word. You say, Pastor, I'm not a preacher. Well, in a sense, your life is preaching. You're communicating with loved ones, and the people you live next to or work with is the communication of the gospel when you get to know them. So we fulfill our ministry by preaching the word. Anticipate resistance. And oh, is that ever true in 2022? And also, can I tell you, if you're going to complete this task God's given you, anticipate suffering. So notice, first of all, we have to preach the word. Paul says to Timothy, I charge you. That was a directive. That was a weighty statement in the presence of God in Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead by his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. In season and out of season means in favorable situations and when it's unfavorable. When people are readily anxious to hear the good news and when they don't want to hear a thing you have to say. Be a faithful witness. I encourage you to just tell others what the Lord's done with you and in you through the power of the Holy Spirit and leave the results up to God. It's incredibly important to be sensitive to the places and locations and conversations that the Lord gives you a part of in others' lives and be sensitive to how you might inject your faith. What he's done for you, for me. Personal testimony has incredible authority because it happened to you. You've experienced it. The hard work when it comes to conveying God's word, John Piper said, in rebuke is not simply to muster enough courage to say the hard things or to patiently persist in calling someone to repentance. He said the hard work involves teaching them God's own words and thoughts and desires from the Bible, to have their words and thoughts and desires shaped by his. The voice, he said once, your brother or sister needs is not yours, but God's. The overarching theme for the church in 2022 is the local church must place its feet firmly on the foundation of the Word of God. God wants to communicate his love to people, but we are so often distracted, even those who know him, that we don't take the time to really pray for those around us, that we might have a venue, an opportunity to share the hope that is within us. And some churches, honestly, just try to attract people with cool object lessons and maybe fog machines and different themes and programs and atmosphere. But that doesn't have the power to change lives. Only Christ can change lives. And he might use fog machines and good music and all the rest. But make no mistake about it. When we are desperate for his mercy and his grace and his presence, he will accommodate us, but often we have not because we ask not. Think of it. The word of God changes lives. I'm reminded what the half-brother of our Lord, James, said once. He said, God chose to give us both through the word of truth that we might be a kind of first fruits of the creation. We are born again or saved by the word of God in Christ Jesus. James goes on humbly, accept the word planted in you, which can save you. The challenge of preaching the gospel in 2022 is faithfully calling people to repentance And people don't believe they need to repent of anything, to turn from. More and more people don't believe in moral absolutes, and they don't believe in sin. But the Word of God hasn't changed since it was written over 1,600 years by 40 different authors. The theme is God wants to reconcile us. And in fact, those of us who are saved, He's given us the ministry of reconciliation. And we want to see people come to know Him. But you're going to face a whole lot of resistance. It's the reality of the culture we now find ourselves in. But that doesn't mean the message should change. We should be just as bold and just as direct. And when we preach, as a person speaks expository sermons, we don't miss anything God has to say. That's why I like to preach really verse by verse through a book of the Bible. And may you and I not ever be guilty of presenting half-truths. We need to preach the whole counsel of God and tell people the truth when we preach. And preach is just proclamation. As a pastor, I'm privileged to speak weekly and sometimes more than weekly to people who have assembled because they want to hear what God has to say to them. That's a heavy responsibility. And I feel the weight of it. I've been a pastor for 34 years. It's not any easier than when I first started. You say, well, you're more experienced, more accomplished. Well, that may be true. But you feel the weight to be accurate, to be a person who rightly divides the word of truth, who puts it out there so it's very clear. And sometimes I feel the weight of eternity thinking, will this person respond? Have I articulated God's word to them effectively? So pray for me, but don't forget that you as a believer have a responsibility to share the hope that is within you. There are people that you could talk to that would never listen to me. And so I encourage you to say, Lord, where are you at work in my life? Would you please place people in my sphere of influence so I can tell them about you? We have to tell the truth that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. And our righteousness is filthy rags in the sight of a holy God. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name given unto men whereby we must be saved. We need to boldly proclaim that the only solution to sin is the life of the risen Lord Jesus Christ and His forgiveness applied to us and our sin debt. Tell it plain, tell it clear, and tell it often. Notice, we have to preach the word, but believe this, anticipate resistance. Paul says to Timothy, the time's coming when people will not endure sound teaching, and having itching ears, they will accumulate to themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. You'll find it interesting, the phrase translated as sound teaching, or better yet, healthy teaching, is contrasted, really, with unhealthy teaching. You say, well, Pastor, what's the difference between healthy teaching and unhealthy teaching? In the immediate and wider context of Scripture, healthy or sound teaching is that which encourages a believer to enter into the world and to live like the Lord Jesus Christ of all things in this world, of all places. The term teaching is how one lives out the message of the gospel and the kingdom of God that has been believed by that individual. Unhealthy teaching is the kind of teaching that pulls away from the world, that tries to be so separate that you really have no non-believing friends. You just are afraid to engage the culture, and I challenge you to not be afraid. In this church, we are privileged to feed 60 to 70 homeless every week. I found out in a recent report that we get based on World Hunger Funds that this church in this city, 3725 El Moro Road, has fed over 1,900 people in the last 3 months. That's called engaging the culture. That's called getting out of these four walls and telling other folks that there is someone who is so desperately in love with you that He died on the cross and rose from the dead, and He offers
hope for you and purpose for you and forgiveness for you. And believing in Him will change the trajectory of your life and affect your family in a positive way. How can we keep this treasure to ourselves? We need to share it often and in many and wonderful, diverse ways. God wants us to embrace the culture, but when you do, you can anticipate resistance. There will be pushback. Healthy teaching seeks love and service and action in the world as their goal. Unhealthy teaching just wants more and more knowledge. It's like someone said, it's like Christians are forever getting ready. We're going to this conference. We're studying this new Bible study. There comes a time when you have to set aside those Bible studies and those conferences and step into the stream of humanity and let the Holy Spirit of God use your life to touch others with the gospel. Those who follow teachers who give them what their itching ears want to hear, and those who are content to gather more and more teachers, listen to more and more sermons, gaining more and more knowledge, are being so busy with pursuing all those goals that they miss out on making an impact with their one solitary life. And I often remind people, the average person lives 25,000 days. That's a little over 4,000 weeks, and if you want to calculate it, it's into your 70s, and then you're stepping off the world stage and stepping into eternity. Let me ask you something. What are you doing about that part of you that will live forever? I tell you, we need to remember that the apostles were not the learned, educated people of their day. They were fishermen empowered by the Holy Spirit. We would do well to remember that God can do extraordinary things through people wholly yielded to Him. What will you do in this coming week to say, Lord, push me out of my comfort zone and make me to be a part of your kingdom's expansion? And remind me that the harvest is plenteous, but the workers are few. Pray to the Lord of the harvest that He would thrust out laborers into the harvest field, but as you go and when you go, anticipate resistance. I'll tell you something else you can anticipate. You can anticipate suffering. Paul says to him, Paul's in Rome, Paul's in prison when he says this. He's in a dungeon-like prison. It's not house arrest like he experienced before. This was a holding cell, basically for someone who had been condemned to death, which he had been by Nero. This is the last book he will write of the 13 books he writes in the New Testament. As for you, he says to Timothy, always be sober-minded, endure sufferings, do the work of an evangelist, and fulfill your ministry. To be sober-minded literally means to not be drunk from wine. As used metaphorically here, it means to be free from every form of mental and spiritual drunkenness, from excess passion and rashness and confusion. It means to be well-balanced and self-controlled so as to keep a cool demeanor and a collected mind. Endure suffering, Paul is saying, meant to suffer physical pain and hardship and troubles and problems and difficulties and evil, distress. And the secular Greek to endure suffering was frequently used to speak about soldiers who would be in combat and would be attacked by the enemy. I remind you something the Oxford professor C.S. Lewis once said. He said, Christians live in occupied territory. The vast majority of people in the United States and the world are not devoted followers of Christ. And so we have our work cut out for us. They will mock your idea of moral absolutes. They will laugh at you when you say that marriage is between a man and a woman. They will think you're out of step when you suggest that abortion stops a beating heart and every child deserves a chance to be born in America. And they will mock you. They will laugh at you. What will you do? Stand on the word. Do everything you can to be faithful to God in a society and in a culture that will push back on you at every turn, and anticipate resistance, and do anticipate suffering, because the judgment of God, I believe, is going to fall across America. It already has started now. The way people mistreat authorities, the way others mistreat people in a position of authority, the way policemen are mocked, We have a culture that doesn't believe in absolutes, doesn't revere the Word of God. Less than 20% of Americans believe that the Bible is God's Word. They've never even read it, but they want to make an opinion about it. We live in a challenging time, and the only hope for this sin-soaked world is the redeeming power of the risen Christ. And I challenge you to believe in Him with all your heart. And as you have the opportunity to speak truth into someone's life, don't shrink back. Step boldly into that conversation and let them know what He's done for you. We need to recapture a sense of destiny in serving God and being people of integrity. There is no such thing, listen to me, as a faithful ministry that is not costly. A painless ministry is shallow and a fruitless ministry. Do you know, at the Nicene Council, an important church meeting of the 4th century AD, of the 318 Christian delegates, fewer than 12 of those 318, less than 12 of them, had not lost an eye or a hand or did not limp on a leg that had been marred by torture for their Christian faith. I'm talking that less than 10% of 312 Christian delegates at the Nicene Council had not faced physical suffering for service to Christ. I believe that the Lord could come at any moment, but should He tarry, I assure you, you will be mocked increasingly for your faith. People will be more in your face in disregarding the things that move your heart and mean the most to you. Anticipate resistance, anticipate suffering, but preach the word. To fulfill your ministry in this context means to lay your life at the feet of Christ. Seek to be led by His Holy Spirit and to desire to use your talents and your abilities to further the gospel until at last heaven is realized and we see Christ face to face. Father, I thank You for Your word. It's not an easy time to preach. Our church attendance has shrunk. People don't seem interested in the things of God as I feel they used to be. And only You, God, and only You and Your Holy Spirit, the Lord Jesus, can compel people to look up to their Redeemer. And I pray they will. I pray that You'd move in Colorado Springs and in Fountain and in Pueblo and the Front Range, across the West and the broad sweeping states of the Union. I pray for the Dakotas and the tip of Texas. And I do pray from sea to shining sea and around the world that before You come and the end draws near, that You'll change lives and touch hearts. And we will see what God can do when a people who know Him call out to Him and believe Him to reach those who at this moment seem so indifferent, so cold, and so resistant. Remind us there was a time when we too were like that. And help us to walk in faith, to walk in the strength of the Holy Spirit, and determine to press on towards the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus is my prayer in His name. In Jesus' name, amen. Pastor Mark Hensley here from the Pikes Peak Park Baptist Church here in Colorado Springs, encouraging you to always preach the word. Anticipate resistance, anticipate suffering, but looking forward to that glorious experience of being reunited with our loved ones and seeing God in Christ and the Holy Spirit is worth it all. It will be worth it all when we see Jesus. Have a great afternoon, folks. Bye-bye. Thank you.